Hey, everybody. Good morning. Dr. Cranky here at the Cranky Show. I wanted to talk this morning a little bit about this business of paint layering and what the heck that means, and or at least what the heck it means to me. It might mean something different for you seasoned veterans of the styrene addiction. You know, I'm in the process of, as I said previously, I'm in the process of primering lots and lots of parts and getting them ready for paint. And so, you know, this business of layering is very important, and it's why I know that quite a few builders keep notes. And I don't tend to keep notes as much or as frequently as I used to these days in terms of the steps, in part because I go through these check systems, you know, very similar to NASA. You know, I start on a pattern and I stick with it, and that's what keeps me out of trouble. But here's what happens, okay? Here's what normally happens to us, those of you who are starting out. Okay, so you primer your body, right? And you're using, you know, you're not paying that much attention to the primer, which is why I make such a big deal about Plastic Coat, because that's the primer that we use exclusively in the laboratory. And, you know, Plastic Coat doesn't pay me to say that. It's just a product that I really like and use. And we've learned better. You know, they've saved us a lot of heartache over time. So we use Plastic Coat. A lot of you are using Duplicolor. A lot of you are using Krylon. We, you know, been there, done that. Plastic Coat is what we use in the laboratory. That's what we use here. You know, let me wet my whistle. So, you know, you primer your body. Then you have asked, you know, do you sand it? Well, depending on how smooth of a surface you get, and with Plastic Coat, believe me, you after two or three mist coats and then a couple of medium to heavy coats, you are going to end up with full coverage and you're going to end up with a very smooth coat. Now, is that smooth enough to put paint on? It could be. I've done it in the past without any problems. But lately, I've learned that if I hit it with, you know, my sanding cloths, beginning with 4,000 grit and moving on to 12,000, you know, sanding very lightly, not, you know, don't put a lot of pressure in it because you're going to cut back down to the plastic. And I'm a proponent of, you know, do it the first couple, do it the way that you normally do it, put pressure on it, and you're going to cut down to the plastic. And you know what? Nothing will happen. All you have to do is reshoot the model with more primer. It's not as scary as when you do you know, rub down to the naked styrene, and you're talking about a base coat, a paint coat. It's gonna be trouble, you know. So, and it's not gonna be that much trouble because once again, you can retape the area, you can reprimer, and then you can re-base coat. Not a big deal. But you know, for those of you who are trying this and learning from the process, it gets scary, and that's why I'm doing this video. You know, to just sort of make, you know, to let you know that, you know, not all is lost. So don't despair, you know, chill, take it easy, and go slow and learn from your mistakes. That's the lesson here. So, you know, you rub out, you not polish, but you rub out, you don't want to make your primer so shiny that it's like a base coat. You know, a primer is a primer. It's that tooth coat that's going to seal the plastic and also provide a place for the subsequent coats of paint to stick. All right. Some people believe that if you sand the primer, then it loses stickability. You know, and that, I don't believe that. Okay, primer is primer, and the paint, you know, rekindles its love affair with the primer, and it hangs on regardless of how rough or smooth it is. Actually, the rougher the better, but you know, it's gonna create a foundation for orange peel. So that's why you want to sort of smooth your primer coat, because the smoother that is, the less chances you are going to have of creating a foundation for orange peel, which is not a big deal because you can polish that out. But, you know, it lets you know right away that it's going to be a rougher time painting the model than it should, you know. So anyway, so you do your primer coat, then you come in and you, let's say you're going to use enamel. You know, most of us rattle can, you know, we start out with a rattle can. So you rattle can your enamel, you wait your, 12 to 14 days for the sucker to gas out. All right, by this point, you might be working on something else. By this point, you might have forgotten that you used enamel. And so you go and you get your clear coat, and let's say it's, this is where the nightmare begins. Let's say it's a lacquer clear. You're going to spray it, and you're going to see it right in front of your very eyes, the horror of watching your paint wrinkle, because you are using systems that are not copacetic, they're simpatico. That's a word I like, or simpatico with each other. And you're going to get a wrinkled paint job, and it's going to be horrible, but there are techniques, by the way. I'm just asserting them here. That way it gives you an option. There are techniques that I'm trying to develop here in the laboratory where that's exactly the effect we want. We want the paint to wrinkle, because then we're going to sand it out, and it's going to create these weird striations and markings when we're doing rust jobs, and weathering. So, but that's a different story here. All right. So you basically, you will start crying, your heart will break because your paint is wrinkling. Well, you're not paying attention to the layering. You have to keep track of the products you are using. You have to keep track of what is going on with your paints and how your paints and, from primer to clear, how the whole paint system works together. Now, we've been using a lot of Future Clear. Future Clear, once it dries, is pretty tough. It's a pretty tough coat. Remember, we use it on floors. And people walk on floors. You ride your motorcycle on your floor. Hey, I do. It takes a lot of punishment. So to come back in with dull coat, to seal in your graphics, your decals, it's not gonna do anything to it. You still want to be careful, and you still want to mist coat a couple of coats and then put a heavier coat on there. But it's a pretty tough cookie when it comes to sealing your paints. And so when you're working with acrylics and enamels, you could use Future Clear. That's fine. I like to airbrush mine. Some people, just brush it on. I like to airbrush it because I want to control the thickness. And again, thickness has a lot to do with layering. So, it's not rocket science. Clearly, you're going to be able to get it, and eventually you learn from your own heartbreaks and from your own mistakes. The minute you get three or four models to wrinkle on you, you will learn that you never, never cover enamels with urethanes. You just never do. Now, here's an experiment you can try out on the spoons. How about you use enamel, you clear the enamel with Future Clear, and then try out urethane clears. You know what? It'd be interesting to find out what happens. I haven't wasted too much time or resources doing those experiments. Actually, that's not true. We've tried it a couple of times, and I haven't been convinced, and I don't, and it's a big leap to go from the plastic spoon to your model car, and you also have to hold your breath, and I don't like doing that. I like knowing exactly what I'm putting on my models and what the results are going to be. So practice on your spoons, practice, and eventually the fear and all self-doubt will erode and fade away, and you'll be more confident as a builder. So keep track of your layering. What are you putting on your models? The opposite of what I was talking about is true. If you start out, let's say you put down a House of Color silver, okay, which is great. I do that all the time. It's a great silver to use, okay, Orion silver. So you put down a coat of Orion silver, and then you come in and you do enamels on top of that. Nothing's going to happen, because enamels over urethanes, there's no reaction. Urethane is a tough, tough paint, so nothing's going to happen to it. But the disaster happens the other way around, as you were very well know. If you put urethanes, hot lacquers, over enamels, they're going to wrinkle up on you. Now, the brilliance the brilliant moment with the Danyo system, where, you know, since he paints with enamels, is the fact that he cuts and thins his enamels with cheap lacquer. And so the enamel gets an infusion of urethane lacquer, and it works. It gases out faster, and then it just becomes a tougher paint coat. But I am always nervous to spray any kind of urethane clear over enamels, even if I've cut the enamels with cheap lacquer. So what do? I just stay within the same system. Then I clear my models with Model Master Clear, cut with cheap enamel, with cheap lacquer thinner, and that's it. And so keep track of these systems, and as I said, you know, you are going to get you are going to get better results time and time again. So anyway, this video's gone on a little bit long, but it's a good discussion for us to have, and so it's important. So keep track of your layering, and from primer all the way to clear, and you're going to learn from your mistakes, and you're going to know what eventually works for you. All right, Cranky Heads, Dr. Cranky here in the laboratory. Have a great day, and have a great styrene adventure. All right, next time. See you next time.